Okay, welcome back to this course program. So as I mentioned, we will be having a 5 days program. So Monday, Tuesday, then Wednesday till noon time we will be having the lecture program, and then we'll be having a small lab, artificial AI lab, in the afternoon of Wednesday. And then Thursday we'll be having GIS, and then the related lab demonstration will be done here. And Friday, of course, the further lecture program, and then we'll be having the onboarding session on Friday evening. So before going to the soft computing techniques and tools, we will have an overview of the water resource management aspects in India. So that is the main theme of our course. Only you know that we are having so many techniques, but we are using all the techniques for the purpose of say doing the management, water resource management. So first from my part I should introduce you. All of you know, I know you are all experts in this area, but from my part I should give a brief overview of the water resource management. Then only we will start off the various aspects of the modeling. So in this the first lecture here, we will be having a brief discussion on the water resource management in India, an overview. So in this first we will discuss the sustainable development and water resource management. Then we will have some discussion on the integrated water resource development and management. And then we will have an overview on the India's water resource management, an overview. So as all of you know that the water is the integral part of our life. Without water, nobody can sustain. So any kind of product, either it is water, land, or any kind of thing, we say nowadays, now last few years, you are hearing about the sustainable development and related issues. So the reason is that you can see that most of the time, say the especially earlier time, now people are more conscious about the sustainability issues. But earlier times, many of the problems, environmental problems, were created. Since people are not thinking the sustainability issues, they were just utilizing whatever is there without thinking about the future. So as far as water is concerned, it is very important aspect, the sustainable development and management. So as I have defined here, you can see here the development and management of water, land, biomass and energy within a time frame to meet with the minimum needs of the ultimate size of population without irreversibly affecting the resource base and while containing the adverse effect on people, flora and fauna. So this is a simple definition of the sustainable development. So as far as water is concerned, you can see that we are having surface water, we are having groundwater. So whatever is, of course, this is a part of hydraulic cycle. So even though it is cycled in an annual basis, but you can see that most of the time, we cannot predict, of course, this much rainfall will be there, or this much rainfall will get at particular location, or with respect to time and space, the rainfall pattern is varying. So due to this reason, we cannot say that, of course, this much is definitely available in this particular year. So due to this reason, so we have to see that whatever is there, it is not only recycled, but we have to see that all the management aspects, the water resource is concerned, either it is surface water or groundwater, we cannot utilize it more than what it should. You can see that many parts of the country, we have the groundwater is concerned, it overdraft of groundwater, many places water table is going drastically down, so that we cannot get it back. So the aspect of this is so called sustainable development, either it is surface water or groundwater is concerned. And then, of course, the sustainability issues are concerned, the economic development decision by the present generation, that means what we are doing today, that should not compromise the capacity of future generations. So as I mentioned, even the groundwater, when you are pumping so much of groundwater, what happens is that, say, this water, the water level is going drastically down, and then if it is not replenished in an annual basis, then you can see that the future generation cannot, say, get the water, the groundwater to the level that we need. So the sustainability issues of water resource management, we have to see that whatever decision you are taking now, whatever management aspects you are doing now, so it should be in such a way that there should not be any drastic effect on the future, or it should not affect the future generations. But of course, in a managerial way, we can say that there should be flexibility, there should be resilience. That should be the way we have to manage. So these are the major issues as far as water resource is concerned. So as all of you know that water is concerned, we are using water for three sectors mainly. One is for food production, that is of course irrigation, and then water for drinking and sanitation purpose, and then of course nature or ecology, that means forest or the livestock or all other purpose. So three sectors we are mainly utilizing the water: food production, then for our own purpose, then of course nature, ecology or animals or the all of the plants and other issues are concerned. So as I mentioned, water is the water is our life. So the main problem is that even though say two-third of the earth is filled with water, but the issue is that only 3% is available as fresh water, and out of this 3% we can utilize only 0.03% as say readily accessible to the mankind. So this is the major issue. So due to this variability of its availability in time and space, as I mentioned, the rainfall is there, but it is varying from just 4 months, June to October, and then at one location, place like Kerala, will be having about 250 or 300 centimeter rainfall, but in Rajasthan we will be having hardly 20 or 30 centimeter rainfall. That means 10% of the what we are getting in Kerala. So that way, the variability and availability in time and space. So that is why we have to develop it, and then the surface water as well as groundwater, we have to manage the available water in a sustainable way. So that is why you have read in newspapers and many other literature that the UNESCO and many other international organizations are talking about the term called integrated water resource development and management. So here, what we mean, the integrated water resource development and management means, say, we are integrating not only the aspect of water, we are integrating the various issues related to water, then the development, overall development in a holistic way, such a way that whatever we are using now or whatever we need for future, we can manage it in an appropriate way. So when we discuss about the water issues, so you can see that say there will be always interaction or interplay between food, people and nature sectors. As I mentioned, we are using water for three sectors: food production, then nature, other nature purpose, and then human beings for the drinking and other purposes. So if you consider the food sector, then you can see that it produces the biomass and then influence the ecosystem positively and sometimes negatively. That means if you are trying to for overproduction, then it may be, even though we are getting more, but then after some time the land become useless, and then the overproductivity also create problems. So there should be always a balance, whatever you need. If you produce some products like rice, if you produce so much, then the price level will go down, and then there will be plenty of things, but then you can see that there will be adverse impacts on this. So as far as water is concerned, we can see that we should utilize in such a way that whatever we are producing in a balanced way, and then in a sustainable way. So then water is concerned, we are having mainly two uses, as all of you know. One is consumptive use and another one is non-consumptive use. So consumptive use is say when we use water for agriculture production, it is consumptive use, or when we are drinking water, it is consumptive use. But when we are using the water for the purpose of navigation or the other type of purpose like navigation, and then the facilities like sports activities, that it is non-consumptive use. But so most of the way we are utilizing the water for consumptive way. But the issues here, the sustainability issues, are that whenever we are producing food, we use a lot of fertilizers, pesticides, and all these things create environmental issues. So we have to see that the water available is used in a sustainable way. So you can see that with respect to the water issues, when we discuss, we can see we'll be discussing about water harvesting. So if we can harvest water, say 1 centimeter of say rainfall per hectare per day, with respect to rainfall available, you can see that water is sufficient for 1,000 people say for 1 year. So that is the calculation which we can make. But so that way, when we discuss the water utilities in India's concerns, say on a world average base, the ratio of agriculture usage, municipal usage, and industrial, the world average is 70% to 15% to 15%. But India is concerned, you can see that is, say, the agricultural sector use so much of water, about 85% of the water is used by the agriculture sector. And then municipal usage is only 8% of the total use, and 7% is used for the purpose of industrial this thing. So that means, what does it mean? So overall, the agriculture production is concerned, average wise, it is almost same, say, with respect to various countries. But India, we are using, or misusing so much of water for agricultural production. So that means, say for example, if water is available through dams or through reservoirs or canal system, then when it is available to the farmers, then it is not utilized in an appropriate way. It is utilized in a very, very say useless way. That means so much of water is wasted. So the production is not coming to the level we want. So the overall world average is 70% to 15%, 50%. But India is concerned, the usage is concerned, 85% for agricultural sector and 8% for municipal sector, and then 7% for the industrial sector. So this is where we need a lot of management. That means whatever water is available, we should use in a sustainable way. We should use it in a very effective way, so that where we need a lot of tools like GIS, remote sensing, or this kind of soft computing techniques, which we will be discussing in the next few days. So where we can reduce the use of water for the agriculture purpose. But of course, I am not saying here that we have to reduce the irrigation, but we have to increase the irrigation potential, but the wastage should be avoided. We should use it, the water, in a sustainable way, so that we can have better production and with less water. So that should be the motive. So here you can see in a global way, the global withdrawal of water for agriculture, industry and municipal use. Here, say last 100 years, a plot is given here. So you can see that this line shows the total withdrawal, and then agriculture withdrawal is the, as I mentioned, it is about say 75% overall the world, but 85% India. So that you can see so much of water is used for agriculture purpose, and then industrial withdrawal is concerned, it is very small, you can see here, and then again municipal withdrawal is again much more smaller. But if you consider with respect to all this utilization, the total effective utilization is this much. That means almost say about 40 to 60% of the water is not utilized effectively. So that means so much of water is wasted. So you can see that this line shows the effective utilization, and with respect to various other utilization, the other curve shows. That way you can see that we need a lot of management of the available water to have a sustainable development, to have the effective management of the water resource is very essential. So just now I told about the term called integrated water resource development and management. So here, under the perspective of UNESCO, here what do they mean by integrated water resource development management is, it is integration of river basin resources, including surface and groundwater. And then we have to integrate the demands, as I mentioned, whether it may be consumptive use or it is non-consumptive use and supplies. And then say starting from very micro level, that means with respect to even you start from a well, or it is watershed, or if you consider major dams and reservoirs, so facilities wise also you have to integrate from mega to micro. And then it is not only water, integrated water resource development management, that term includes all human aspects and eco aspects, ecosystem is considered. And when we are talking in a scientific way, we have to utilize all the science and technological tools available with respect to social, economical, and in a synergic way we have to put it together. So that is the definition of the integrated water resource development and management given by the UNESCO. So it is not only development of the water sector, but it is overall development with respect to the people needs, with respect to the ecological needs, with respect to the environment issues. So that is why everything is coming together. And you can see, all of you know that we cannot just consider only water as a separate issue. It is an issue of human being, it is an issue of ecosystem, it is the issue of the total environment. So our question here is, our various tools like science and technological tools like modeling, like remote sensing, like GIS or any other soft computing, how we can utilize it in an effective way, such a way that we can have better management, we can have better development of the available water resource system. So here, when we consider, as I mentioned, the water resource development and management is considered, the smallest unit is so-called watershed. I hope all of you know what is a watershed. Watershed is a geographic area which we can delineate in such a way that with respect to the geopolitical boundaries, we can delineate an area. It may be small area or it may be larger area. So within this perspective of integrated water resource development management, we will be, when we consider this as a watershed scale, we can deal with water harvesting. That means how much water, say, as I mentioned, even though before, taking water from long distance, like for example, Mumbai is concerned, we are getting water from 20 or 30 kilometers away from various reservoirs like Tansa and other reservoirs, and we are carrying, we are giving sufficient treatment there, and then we are taking the water to the city of Mumbai, and the same thing is there in Bangalore or in many other cities. But if you can utilize the water available, say for example in Mumbai itself, then you can see that we can save a lot of money, and then we can save the water which you are taking from 30 kilometers. If the local people, if they can get that water there itself, then they can produce more food, they can have better agriculture. But what we are taking, that all this water is transported to the city of Mumbai, so what is happening is that you know all the difficulties. So, but what we are discussing here is, say, when we discuss about the India water resource development and management on a watershed scale, so we will be discussing about water harvesting. So, whatever is available at particular location, how we can utilize it. And then, of course, say, with the utilization of surface water, and then lift irrigation, of course, groundwater we can effectively utilize. And then appropriate water conservation practices. So you know that number of ways we can conserve the water. Say we can reduce the evaporation, we can reduce the seepage, we can do it which way it is possible. So these are all local, depends upon the location. And then of course you can see that watershed scale development is concerned, the people participation is very important, and then we should go for appropriate land use and planning. And then the ultimate aim is the poverty alleviation and then social development. So as I mentioned, this is possible only in a sustainable way. We cannot just overdraw the available groundwater and utilize it in a stretch so that the future generation will be affected. So we have to do everything in a sustainable way, and we have to see in all these aspects. The various case studies we have conducted in the recent times shows that if people participation is there, then it will be much more effective. So on the India water resource development management issues on a watershed scale, all these aspects. So here I have given a flow chart. This is taken from C. Anupam K. Singh and one of our common papers which we have published in 2002. So this flow chart shows how we can effectively, so on a watershed scale, how we can effectively utilize, we can have a system in such a way that we can improve the total aspect with respect to water issues is concerned. So as I mentioned, we can start with the village scale or the watershed scale, then we can build the capacity building with respect to financial support from various aspects. So here the water harvesting is a major issue, lift irrigation, then on-farm employment, and then water and soil conservation, and then afforestation activities, and then community support service. So all these things can come together. So in a typical, in a very effective integrated water resource development management model on watershed basis, we can have all these aspects together, so that ultimate aim is we will have improved quality of life and we will have sufficient water. So our studies showed that if sufficient water is available for a particular watershed or village all over the, that means they can produce more agriculture, more food can be produced, and then that will improve the farmers can sell these products to other people, and then they can have better, they can get more money, and then their overall life will be improved. So this is what we have seen by studying many the many watershed scale projects, like the project in Jabua or in Madhya Pradesh, or the project run by Anna Hazare in Maharashtra. So all these places, it shows that an integrated water resource development management by considering all the aspects are very important, especially on a watershed scale. Since we are now discussing here the soft computing techniques and various tools, how we can use these advanced technologies for integrated water resource development management, say for example on a watershed scale. So you can see that, so as I mentioned, the remote sensing is a major tool which gives lot of information for modeling land use and many other purposes. And so if you get to the remote sensing data, then we can put it in a GIS environment, and then with the help of, we can develop a watershed management system such a way that that can be effectively put into a management information system, so we can develop based upon this. So as a scientist, as an engineer, you can, the modern tools like remote sensing, GIS, or all the soft computing techniques which we'll be discussing, or modeling techniques, we can utilize in such a way that this will be available. So this will enhance the total the output on a either on a watershed basis or on a river basin basis. So finally, say we were discussing about the sustainability issues. So as I mentioned, in a broader scale on integrated water resource development and management, so we are having the people, then water, land, and then of course the flora and fauna of the, all these things. So the sustainability issues are concerned, for people is concerned, if you are having stable population, survival and fulfillment of minimum needs, all these issues will be coming under the category of sustainability issues in the within the perspective of integrated water resource development and management. And water is concerned, loss of storage due to siltation, fall of groundwater table, all these issues we have to deal as far as sustainability issues in water resource development and management. And then of course, if more water is available, it is a problem. We are having water logging, we will be having salinity issues, and wetland and marshland, all this problem. If we don't have sufficient water, then there will be drought situation, and then we are having deserts and other related problems. So in a sustainable way, we have to deal with the people, we have to deal with the ecosystem, we have to deal with the water and the land. So these are the major issues, the sustainability issues as far as integrated water resource development and management is concerned. So here, as far as sustainability issues are concerned, product is concerned, say, as I mentioned, the agriculture product is, say, or the food production, so we should have balanced composition between what we produce and what we can sell and what we can market, and then quantity and quality and the supply and all other aspects are concerned. And then water is concerned, we should have the facilities, like whether we should go for larger dams or we should develop the on watershed basis or small scale development. So these are the major issues. And then biomass is concerned, the conservation of biodiversity, and issues like gene banks, tissue culture, energy plant, all these things will be coming to picture. So everything, say, when we are putting all this in a holistic way in the terms of integrated water resource development management, we can put sustainability indicators for each aspects, and then depending upon, say, these indicators will vary from place to place, it is not the same for all the locations. So accordingly, according to the priorities, according to the needs, we can put different indicators for all these issues, and then we can develop a sustainable development model with respect to water, land, the human being, and then of course the ecosystem is concerned. So now we will have a brief discussion about the water resource availability in India, and then what are our the projected water requirement in 2050, that means in 45 years time, how much water we need. So what way we have to develop the various water resource available on our disposal. So you can see that if you just check with the various aspects of like water availability, land availability, so India has 2% of world's land, 4% of fresh water, and 16% of population, and 10% of its cattle. You can see that there is the distribution is not at all normal. You can see that say we are having only 2% of world's land and only 4% of fresh water, but our population is more than 16% of the total population of the world, and even cattle wise also we are having about 10% of the cattle. So these are the major issues. So what is the resource available is much lesser, and our needs are much larger. So how we can manage by using various techniques, how we can manage the water resource in a sustainable way. And geographic areas concerned, say we are having 329 million hectares of which 47% is cultivated, 23% approximately now it would have reduced even further, forested, 7% under non-agriculture use, and 23% land is put as wasteland, since even if put a lot of efforts, it is very difficult to produce agriculture from this land. So if you consider, say, the per capita availability of land 50 years ago, that means in about 1950, the land availability as far as India is concerned, it was about 0.9 hectare. But now, say, 50 years ago, it was 0.9 hectare, and now it may be about 0.5 or something like that. And now in 2050, I mean, if we predict for 2050, it is going to reduce 0.14 hectare. So that means by 2050 our population may be more than 120 crores. So you can see that again further whatever is available is going to drastically reduce. So and as far as the area of, under cultivation is concerned, India is concerned, 37% is irrigated, which produce 55% of our food requirement. So you can see that we are now producing about 200 metric tons of food. So out of which 55% is produced from the 37% of the irrigated lands, and then we are having about 63% of the rain-fed land. That means it is mainly only one crop is generally possible, and remaining maybe some few finger millets and other things may be possible. So that 63% of the area is producing only 45% of the food requirement. So if you consider for 50 years, that means many of the people says that this is ultimate. If you cannot go beyond this, that what is there in 50 years, so that means 2050. So this, the central government of India wants to increase this agriculture production, the irrigated area, 37% to at least 50%, such that there will be 50% irrigated land and 50% non-irrigated land, so that the food production can go to, so the irrigated land may produce about 75% through various water resource management practices and agriculture practices, and then remaining 25% may produce by this 50% of the land where it is not irrigated. So our food requirement by 2050 may be about 500 metric ton. So these are the major issues. So the entire the land is not distributed with respect to the population as far as India is concerned. Water is also very less, and available water is also very much varying, as you can see in the coming slides. So you can see that in the last 1970 onwards we are having this revolution called Green Revolution. So with the last 50 years, say in agriculture production, say 1951 was about 65 metric ton, it has gone up to 200 metric tons by 2001, and command area irrigation was only 22.6 million hectare in 1951, that has gone to 90 million hectare. But then the problem was everything was going perfectly okay, but the population also tripled. That means it was 33 crores in 1951, then it has gone to 100 crores. So that is why the major issues. So you can see that now to feed the population by 2050, as I mentioned, the population may further go to another 20 or 25 crores more may be added to the Indian population. So we need another green revolution, or according to Dr. M.S. Swaminathan, we need a second green revolution to cope up with such a high population, maybe within the next 50 years. So there we need a lot of water management issues. We have to, whatever is available, we will be briefly discussing how much water is available. So with respect to what is available, we have to cope up in such a way that we should produce about 500 metric tons of food by 2050, to provide sufficient water and amenities to the people. We should manage the water in an appropriate way. So you can see here the rainfall map of India. So you can see that here in locations like Kerala or Western Belt, and then Eastern Belt where heavy rainfall is there, it is some locations it is more than 4000 centimeter. But you can see that in some locations like Rajasthan, this here you can see that it is varying from 0 to 100 millimeter. This is for 400 centimeter 4000 millimeter. So here it is varying from, it may be hardly 10 centimeter in these locations, and then this areas you can see it is almost average, it is varying from 400 to 1000 millimeter or 100 centimeter. So average rainfall of India is concerned, you can see that it is about 114 centimeter. So this is the major problem. As I mentioned the morning also, we are having a rainfall which may be sufficient for the overall population, but here we are having a very and the distribution is very, very in a difficult way. That means you can see that here some location it is a large amount of water rainfall, but some location it is very, very less. So the distribution is not unique. Distribution is very, very varying. It is such a way that we need a lot of management practices to cope up with whatever we need. And then if you check the India's river basins are concerned, you can see that here we are having river Ganga, river Brahmaputra, and all these rivers carrying so much of water, and then going to the Bay of Bengal. And but here in central India is concerned, even though we are having number of rivers, the flow through these rivers are much less, and then the rivers are full only, the sufficient water is flowing only through monsoon, and afterwards most of the rivers become dry. So that also the water is, so that way you can see that the water distribution is not at all normal in many parts of the country. So if you consider the basin wise statistics, the surface water potential of India is concerned, you can see that Indus river, say the potential is about 73.31 cubic kilometer per year. Ganga is concerned 525, Brahmaputra barrack basins 585, and Godavari 110, but all other rivers much less. So that you can see that all this, most of these rivers flowing northwestern region, we are having so much of water, but the southern region or the central region, we are having very less water. So on an average, you can calculate per year, we are having about 1900 cubic kilometer water. We are getting on an average basis cubic kilometer per year. But out of this, you can see that about 50 to 60% is almost here. You can see that it is occurring through the river Ganga and Brahmaputra river basin. So that is our major issues, and that is why earlier Government of India, Central Water Commission, and National Water Development Agency, they have put the proposal for interlinking of river basins, so that some of the water from the northwestern sides we can transfer to central India or even to southern India, so that we can have sufficient water in the water scarce areas. So as I mentioned here, there is a skewed distribution of water resource in the country. So Ganga Brahmaputra basin, we are having about if you take India, including Ganga and Brahmaputra together, we are having about 1202 cubic kilometer of water. That means about 62% of the total water is flowing through these river basins, Ganga, Brahmaputra, Meghana, etc. So here, out of this, the utilization is only 274, that is about only 40%. That means what can be utilized is only is this much. And west flowing rivers, we are having only, say, the area under this rivers is about 11.31 million hectares, and then we are having only 201 cubic kilometer per year flowing through. So you can see that there is a very drastic, this distribution is so skewed that it is very difficult to manage. In some locations like eastern side or northwestern eastern side, we are having so much of water, but central side and southern side we are having very less water. So this skewed distribution, we should go for interbasin transfer of water. That is a key need. So as all of you know, the river interlink plan has been conceived by the National Water Development Agencies. All these details are available in their website. So as their proposals, there will be two components. One is the Himalayan components, and then another one is peninsular components. So the Himalayan components, about 17 interlinking of rivers components, and then the southern links are concerned, about 12, so about 29 links they have proposed. And here these are the Himalayan components, and then he can see the peninsular component. So out of this, even though all the now the DPR detailed project reports are available for most of these links are concerned, and now I'm very happy to inform you that at least one link has been started. It is in Barak river between between Uttar Pradesh and Bihar. One link, the work is already started, but now the previous government was very much eager to implement this on phase wise, but now the present government is, anyway, we cannot say it is going slow, but they are taking one by one. So I hope maybe in few years time we will be having more links of this interlinking of within the project of interlinking of river basins. So some of the problems, I am not saying that this, I will not 100% say this will solve all the problems, But to certain levels, wherever I am not saying you should go on an entire complete implementation also at a stretch, but as now the government of India is doing, already one link has started, another link is almost deeply complete, all the issues are sorted out, and then they may start that second link work also very soon. So that way it is progressing, and then if this river interlinking project is taken place appropriately, then we can see that some of the water scarcity problems may be solved. So some of the inferences from the river basin statistics, you can see that the Himalayan river waters, we are having so much of 1200 billion cubic meter or 1200 cubic kilometer of water per year. Out of this, only 300 cubic kilometer can be utilized. So that is the issue. And Himalayan large dams presently store about 80 billion cubic meter of water, and new dams under consideration could store about 90 billion cubic meter of water. And peninsular rivers, 400 billion cubic meter of water can utilize out of 700 available. And the peninsular larger dams presently store only 160 billion cubic meter of water. And new dams under consideration may further we can add 45 billion cubic meter of water. And in all, larger dams presently store about 240 billion cubic meter of water. And new dams under consideration could store another 135. So that total storage this could be about 375 billion cubic meter only. So these are the major problems. So here and then of course as I mentioned, the groundwater is also another issue. Basin wise groundwater distribution is also given, it is there in your lecture notes. So you can see that the groundwater basin is also accordingly surface water distribution in Ganga, Brahmaputra, Varavari basins, lot of groundwater potential is there. We are not able to utilize it appropriately. The list is given here. So we are having about 430 cubic kilometer of water is available per year as far as groundwater resource is concerned. The issues are, you can see that we have to lift this water, and then of course as I mentioned, we have to also see that the water is recharged appropriately. So all these issues we have to sort out within the water resource management. So finally, this all these things I have put in together in a table, India's present yearly water balance. A summary, say if you consider the entire precipitation falling throughout the country, it is about 4000 cubic kilometer, and inflow from coming from Himalaya and other places, it is about 400 billion cubic meter of water or cubic kilometer of water. So totally we are having about 4400, and then blindly we can put about 50% goes as evapotranspiration or whatever other some of the losses, so like evaporation transpiration, so it is about 2200 goes, and infiltration about 300 cubic kilometer, and available for whatever we can get or we can utilize is 1900. And again, say all this, there are certain number of difficulties to utilize NDS, what is 900. So utilizable, finally the experts have put us 1100, and further this out of plus another 300 can be extended. So that means, say present withdrawal is about 630 billion cubic meter of water. So what is can be possible is 58 out of this what is can be utilizable, and still available is 470, that means 42% still we can develop, and extendable as I mentioned this 300 can be further extended with like interbasin transfer etc. That means we can add another 28%. So utilization is concerned, irrigation is the major sector where about 85% of the water is. So if we can go through various management measures, if we can reduce it, lot of water will be available. So presently the drinking and municipal usage is about 4.5%, industry 3%, energy 3.5%, and all others 6%. So that this is the present yearly water balance for the country. So as I mentioned, if you go for a 2050, that means in 50 years time or 45 years time, what is the possibilities? So for growing, as I mentioned, in the for the population in 2050, we need about 500 metric tons of food. So for that, for growing food during in 2050, we should have about say 800 billion cubic meter of water, and drinking water plus domestic municipal use of rural population, say at this rate we need about 100 billion cubic meter of water, and hydropower and other energy generation we need about 70 billion cubic meter of water, industrial use we need about 100 billion cubic meter of water, navigation use 15, and the loss of water by evaporation from reservoirs, this is only for reservoirs, about 76 billion cubic meter, and environmental ecology 20. So total we need about 1200 billion cubic meter of water by the year 2050. So you can see that what is available is, even if you go for extension, it is about 1400 billion cubic meter of water. So the population is further going from to by what is predicted in 2050, then it will be very, very difficult situation. As I already some of our speakers mentioned, there will be water war maybe in future. So these are the major issues with the, what is available, what is what we can utilize, and what is the future scope or future the an overview of future the water resource availability of the country. So now we have already briefly discussed earlier the possibility of watershed development aspects. So that also Government of India is putting lot of importance and lot of efforts are put in this direction. So you can see that the many of the areas are water scarce, and then say if we can, whatever is with respect to rainfall, we can harvest it and then utilize, that will be very, very useful. So I am not going to all the details here. So the watershed development is concerned, say whatever we have seen is that it is two aspects. One is water recharging through various means to the aquifer system, and another one is surface pondage, like through ponds, then through small reservoirs, check dams, etc. So this many cases, very successful cases like Jabua, the cases in Maharashtra, like what is done by Anna Hazare. So like that, many successful cases are there. So what I feel as a water resource expert, we should go for not only watershed development but also some types of reservoir development, and then interbasin transfer. All these things should come together so that a complete management of the water resource system, what is available, is needed in a to achieve our goals in a sustainable development way. So here many of the issues, like you know that this rainwater harvesting, all these things are ancient wisdom. That means it was there for many centuries. It is not a new technique. So now what we can do, as I mentioned, through use of GIS, through use of remote sensing, through modeling, whether how we can marry the ancient wisdom with the modern science and technology outputs, so that we can reach new heights, we can manage the water in an appropriate way, such that we can get the sufficient water, say as the predicted for even for 2050. So here I have put a table where the water supply costs are concerned. You may ask why we should go for the water transfer, interbasin transfer, or why we cannot go only for water harvesting. So here, as per Keller and others, here the prices, the possible prices in dollars terms are put here. So that means initial, including the initial investment. So large storage projects, why people are going for larger reservoirs? You can see that this is the cheaper availability of water. So if you go for larger projects, so with $8 to $110, we can have so much of storage, and this include the infrastructure also. And then media and small scale, again further the price increases. And then if you go for desalinization of seawater, as many of the Gulf countries are utilizing, you can see the price are very, very high, including distillation. And then the conservation practice, like water harvesting, also you can see it is not so high. Here the price is only $40 to $300, what is the possibility for including the infrastructure for 1000 cubic meter, the initial infrastructure, and groundwater development and pumping is also varying from 22. So these 2-3 aspects for a country like India, we don't have so much of infrastructure, we don't have so much money to spend. So if we can go for some of the large scale projects, then some of the watershed scale projects, and then we appropriately tap the available groundwater, then that may be a better way of utilization, better way of management as far as water is concerned. So now I am posing so many questions to you. So we need so much of water by 2050, or now also it is scarce in many places. So where does the water come? So there are many questions which you can ask yourself. So the questions are whether you have to go for new dams, or whether we shall go for interbasin transfer, as we have already seen the Government of India proposal of the, that means the interringing of rivers. So where we should go? So these are all big questions, and then I cannot just say only this or that, but as I mentioned, maybe 2-3 components coming together may be the best option for the country. So new dams, of course, there is number of locations where we should go for new dams without much environmental problems. And then, of course, as I mentioned, instead of going for entire linking of the rivers, if we can link some of the rivers together, and then some interbasin transfer of water is done, that will be very, very useful. And then groundwater is concerned, you can see that, as I mentioned, most of the available groundwater is there in the, with respect to the Inter-Gangetic basin, where so much of groundwater is available that is not at all utilized. So that we can definitely utilize. But whenever we are going for groundwater utilization, you should see that we also appropriately recharge the groundwater system such that overdraft is not allowed, and then it is developed in a sustainable way. Then demand management. As we have already seen, demand management is very essential. We are wasting so much of water in the agriculture sector. So how we can improve through whether drip irrigation or the other kinds of irrigation management such a way that the demand can be managed. And then water savings, that means increase in efficiency, reduce evaporation, then water productivity, increase in crop per drop. And then finally, if we cannot do the whatever we need in all these things, then of course the virtual water. All of you know what is virtual water. Virtual water is when we are importing 1 ton of the wheat or rice from other countries like Australia or Canada, then we are actually importing the water itself. Since this much, so much of water is needed to produce 1 ton of wheat or the food products. So when we are importing the food, that means we are importing the water. So that is a virtual water. So how we can manage all these things. Then, as I mentioned, water for food sufficiency and security of India is concerned, irrigated area covers about 40% only. So the remaining is rain fed. So how we can manage, how we can, whatever the, with respect to the water harvesting, whether we can improve or through interbasin transfer, we can go for more irrigation, or whether through large scale development of the groundwater available, or large scale development of the available transferring from one river to another or one basin to another. So that is what we have to check. So water for food sufficiency and security. So as I mentioned here, when we discuss all these aspects, if you go to any of such seminars, you can see a number of voices, number of views, since different experts will be having different viewpoints. So the questions are, as I mentioned, whether we shall go for mega projects like Sardar Sarovar projects or Narmada River projects. It creates a lot of water potential, but simultaneously it brings a lot of environmental problems also. So whether we shall go for the mega projects or we shall go for micro level projects, say like watershed scale projects, like small check dams, and then we utilize the water available in that area. So the question is, of course, as I mentioned earlier, my viewpoint is that we need a combination of many of these things together. And then large scale projects or small scale projects, and then we may ask the question whether we shall go for surface water or groundwater. And then we may ask the question like the storage or run off the river, that means for even for power production, we can pump back the water to the reservoir and then go for that. And then we can just utilize what is flowing through the river, or we can go for lift irrigation, and then gravity or pressurized system or top down. So development models are concerned, all of you know that there are various models like top down or bottom upwards. There is different scales of models are there. So similarly, in water resource management also considered, we can have different types of models. So, and then of course we can have centralized models, decentralized models. All of you know the problem of India is concerned, the central ministries, it has got only an advisory role. The water is a state issue. So that is why issues between Karnataka and Tamil Nadu, issues between Kerala and Tamil Nadu, or different states, also it is a big issue. So the question now here, we may ask whether we should completely centralize, that means the water issues should be centralized so that it can be done. But then some people may say no, we have to decentralization. So all these questions, so it has got many answers. It is not only single answer. So it depends upon the various conditions, various situations. And then, of course, like you can see that as I mentioned, especially the development issues in the irrigation sector and the watershed sectors are concerned. In the 90s, 70s, and 80s, so much of bureaucratic control were there. So this has, you can see that whatever we are proposed to develop, whatever we need to achieve, many of the projects could not achieve. So the main reason is that it is completely controlled by bureaucrats or engineers, the PWD engineers or who are there. They are creating on their own way. They are not discussing with the local people what they want, where the dam should be there, where the various measures should be there, should be adopted. So without people participation, many of the developments has taken place last 30, 40 years. And then you can see that whatever we should achieve through that project, many of the times it has not achieved. So in this way, I can definitely say that we have studied few of the cases like in Jabu and other areas. We have seen that wherever people participation is there, especially watershed scale development, there is a tremendous achievement has been done. That means it is not the bureaucrats design particular projects and implement it, but it is with the help of people, NGOs are coming together, and then they are implementing the project with the help of the people and then for the people. So there is efficiency, then efficacy, and transparency of governance, everything is, and then finally the project is handed over to the local people such that it is managed appropriate way. So this, many of the role models, like as I mentioned, what is happened in Raligan Siddhi in Maharashtra or Jabua or many other areas, you can see that wherever people participation is there, people are taken into confidence, people are taken in the various issues of water management, the success are there. So what I want to emphasize here is that, so of course we have to utilize all these modern techniques, modern things, and all the aspects, but we should go in such a way that all the managed issues are sorted out. But we are creating, say if you are creating a reservoir, if you are building a dam, it is for the people. So we should also take the people into confidence, and then we should go in such a way that everything is managed in a sustainable way of development is very important especially in the area of water resource management, and the environment issues are also very important. So in the next few days we will be discussing, so this is an introductory lecture on this water resource development and management. So the various top, the soft computing techniques starting from numerical modeling, GIS, remote sensing, and various other things, how we can effectively utilize for the water resource management. So that is what we will be discussing in the next few days here by various professors and various experts in this area.